God's peace. We've got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit with you today, tomorrow, and every day thereafter. So let me ask you a question. And you don't have to shout out an answer, but you can if you want to. Let me ask you a question. What things are you good at? What are you good at? What things just seem to come natural? I'm going to share with you one of the things, for me, one of the things that comes naturally to me is languages. There are Hebrew. Just kind of clicks. It makes sense in my brain. I've been learning Spanish. Both my daughters take Spanish in school. And I've been learning kind of vicariously through them, especially Alana, as she goes in even deeper. She loves Spanish. Especially as she goes in even deeper in Spanish, she learns it more and more. So I'm learning it too. Olé. Some technical stuff, putting things together, like computer programs and computer stuff, that comes a little more naturally to me too. What doesn't come naturally, what I am absolutely no good at, is anything dealing about being handy with tools. I am not a handy guy, it's a struggle for me. I'm going to tell you right now that I cannot visualize in my brain, and I can't tell you from smallest to largest or anything like that, the different wrench sizes. I can't lay them out for you. It's not up there. Sometimes I get confused. Tightening and loosening things, I still have to do the ready, tidy, lumpy, loosey stuff. But that's me. In fact, I struggled on whether or not to pay this, but I guess I'll just pay anyway. I guess it was a couple of weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, I came in to change a light bulb up there in Valerie. And I had the light bulb in hand, and I made the joke to the people, the ushers, the greeters out there. I said, well, we're going to find out how many pastors it takes to change a light bulb. Apparently, it takes more than one. Because the light bulb broke off in my hand. The old light bulb broke off in my hand. The base is still up in the socket. And I looked at the old light bulb, and I looked up there, and I said, yeah, that's about it. I'm not good at stuff like that. I even spent, again, I'm not making this up, I spent half a day one time trying to change the chain on my chainsaw before I realized not only did I have to chain backwards, but I kept tightening and loosening the chain goes backwards. I'm not good at mechanical stuff. It just doesn't work in here. But here's the thing. We all have talents of some sort. And as they relate to our Christian life, they're more than just talents. They're not just talents. They are gifts that the Holy Spirit gave to us. They were given to us. We read in our epistle reading this morning that the body of Christ may be built up. Now, maybe that body of Christ and how you, and as an individual, can contribute to the building up of the body of Christ. Maybe that means a worldwide body of Christ. Maybe there's something there. Maybe it's the local parish. Maybe it's small Bible studies. Maybe the body of Christ simply means the body of believers and people that live in your home. But regardless of who that is, the Holy Spirit gives gifts to his children. So, for epistle reading from Ephesians, let's just set the context quickly here. The church in Ephesus grew from a literal riot in the streets. There were people who rioted against believers in Christ because believers in Christ stopped buying the statues of the goddesses that these people made. They were losing money. So they rioted against the Christians. Now the people who were believers were called at that point the Way. We weren't always called Christians. Originally we were called the Way. And the Way recognized what was going on over here. They recognized how these teachings were false, and they recognized how they were being blown around by all sorts of false teachings and doctrines. And once they had once lived that life, and they left it once when they ran smack dab into amazing grace. And in response, the Holy Spirit gave gifts. Gifts to spread the gospel, gifts to bring people together into a unified whole, gifts to build up the church, gifts to protect the church from false teachings, and gifts to better get to know our Abba's heart is shown through Jesus. And the same thing is still true today. The same Holy Spirit gives the same gifts today. The ones listed in this reading in Ephesians are as a partial list. There's only a few of them. There's many others listed in the Bible. The real question is, what are we going to do with the gifts that God gave us? Well, first and foremost, though, we have to make sure we understand here. We have to remember how we have the gifts. That's very important. We have spiritual gifts because of the death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. If the cross and the empty tomb had not happened, the Holy Spirit wouldn't have come. Remember what Jesus said to his disciples, unless I leave, the Holy Spirit will come. It is only because of the pivotal events of the crucifixion and the resurrection that we have spiritual gifts. They are rooted in that. That, in turn, means that all spiritual gifts need to be used to point back to the resurrection, the forgiveness of sins, the promise of heaven to all who call on Jesus as their Savior. All right, Pastor, that sounds good. What if I don't have a gift? Yeah, no, you do. You have a gift. God says so. Each and every person has been uniquely wired. Some more unique than others, but have been uniquely wired to be talented, to be gifted in an area. And when those wirings are coupled with the power of the Holy Spirit, these wirings ignite in a very powerful way to accomplish what God wants us to accomplish right where He has put us. And, let's be honest, that's where I just lost a bunch of you. That's where it gets hard for some people. That's where people struggle, right with there. You see, it's one thing to do nice things for people. It's one thing to say, no, I'm not good at this, I can do that, right? It's one thing to do that, but it's another thing entirely to do things for the express purpose of using our gifts to point people to Christ. So often we're okay with doing activities or doing things that make us feel good, or because we're doing something nice, we're okay with that. But the struggle comes when we talk about centering what we're doing in the gospel purpose of pointing people back to Jesus. Why? Why does that bother us? The thing is, if all we're doing is just performing random acts of kindness, if all we're doing is just being nice, people, helping them out, using, yeah, I can do this, I'll help you with this. If all we're doing is that, without somehow pointing people to Christ, you and I and the churches around the world, we are no different than any other civic organization. There's nothing different between us and Salvation Army, Red Cross, Good Lord. There's no difference. Unless we're pointing people back to Christ, if we're using the gifts that the Holy Spirit has given us, then we are doing what we are supposed to individuals as a church. Now let me be clear, and I don't want anyone to misunderstand. I am not talking about all of us running up to everybody we come across, everybody we meet, and asking them, do you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior? That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not. But I am talking about what Jesus is talking about, what the Spirit tells us, is to be salt and light all the time. Being a speaker and doer of God's word, and through our actions and words, pointing people to Jesus. Pastor, I don't know what my gift is. Well, let's find out. There are spiritual gifts inventories that we can go through. I'd be happy to walk through it with you. You can look at it, you can review. The thing is, here's the point. As Christians, if you are sitting here right now, as Christians, if you are watching this online, if you're listening to it on our website, or have downloaded it from the iTunes, if you are a Christian, you have a spiritual gift. A gift that has been given you by the Holy Spirit, rooted in the cross and the empty tomb, and is to be used for spreading the gospel. Building up the body of Christ, for the unity of the church, for growing in the knowledge of the Son of God. And right there it is. That's the key, that's the foundation. The knowledge of the Son of God. Because from that everything else springs. But here's the thing. See, languages, here's the thing. The word that gets translated as knowledge in our reading, where it says in Ephesians, where it says that we grow in the knowledge of the Son of God, that word is gnosko. And it doesn't mean to know about something. It is a very specific word. There are other words that the Holy Spirit could have used for knowing something. The other words he didn't use. He used this very specific word. And what it means is to know deeply, to know definitely, to know something fully, to know something so well that it is almost second nature. That's what it means. God has given us gifts to help one another grow in the faith, in the unity, and in the deep personal knowledge of Jesus so much so that it's almost second nature. See, It's not about knowing facts and figures about Jesus. Even non-believers can rattle off facts and figures about Jesus. It's about knowing Jesus. It's about the relationship to the Father through the Son, empowered by the Spirit. It's about the deep-seated change of heart, mind, life-impacting knowledge of Jesus. And we are all in this together. And we were put here together to help each other attain that. And to reach out to unbelievers to help them, too. So what? So what now? What are we left with? How are we going to walk out? Where are we going to walk out of here with us today? Or with today? First and foremost, and always, we have to remember that our God loves us. Jesus said, God is love. Not only does he love us, his children, but he loves those who are not his children. And his love is so great that he gives us, his children, gifts to build one another up and to reach out to those who don't know him, who will go to hell when they die if they don't know Jesus. God's love. Second thing to remember, too, is that the gifts that he gives us are unique to the person. Not everybody has the same gifts. Not everybody has been wired the same way. So, we need to not be jealous of somebody else's gift, or think that if we work hard enough, maybe if I just work hard enough, I can eventually get this gift, I can eventually attain this. This also means we need to recognize then what the gifts that we are that we have and the ones that we don't. That means we need to stay out of the way. We need to not try to exercise gifts that we don't have. Instead of letting somebody else who has those gifts exercise them. When we do that, we cause more damage than not. Let me tell you about my friend Wes. Wes is the manager and the head mechanic at His Hands Auto in Bullet Creek, Michigan. His Hands is a ministry, a Messiah Lutheran Church, and they serve the Tri-County areas. Here's the thing about Wes and His Hands. They don't overcharge. In fact, His Hands has been known, and they do this, they charge absolutely no labor for anybody who is in financial need. They won't charge labor. And the labor that they do charge for people who are not in financial need is minimal. It's like half or even more than half less than what other garages charge. He even gets cars. People donate cars to His Hands. And they take them, they clean them up, they fix them up, they make them roadworthy, and then they give them away. Again, people who need them, people who are in dire financial straits and need vehicles, they give this stuff away. When you go into His Hands on, when you talk to the people, when you talk to Wes, it is clear that you are in a Christian business. You're going to hear phrases like, God bless you. And as you tell people, mechanics, what's going on with the car, you're going to hear things like, can I pray with you? You ever have a mechanic with dirty, greasy hands and blackness under the fingernails take your hands and want to pray with you? That's what you're going to get at His Hands Auto. Wes uses his gifts, and the mechanics there use their gifts to bless and support and lift up and edify the body of people that come across their threshold every day. And not only that, I'd like to set all that aside for a second. They're really good mechanics. They are really, really good at what they do. Really good. Wes has never been behind me. There is no mechanic career waiting for me after I retire from the ministry. That ain't going to happen. But let's just pretend I said to you this morning, you know, I know Wes. Wes is a friend of mine. I've talked to him. I think I got this. I'll be happy to change the brakes on the car for you. How many of you are going to trust me to do that? You shouldn't. You shouldn't. Maybe rather than trying to be a Wes Jr., being jealous of his gifts, wanting to work to get his gifts, I can acknowledge what he has and support him and His Hands Auto through other ways and focus on what I've been gifted to do and find that working together. That's actually the third and final thing. What do we do with all this? We come alongside one another to help out and to encourage each other. Maybe that's praying. Praying. Maybe that's something as simple as, honestly, it's volunteering for something. You need help? I can do that. Maybe it's filling the gaps that you see exists and is open. The point point is we do it together. For the building up of the body of Christ, for the unity of the body of Christ, for the spreading of the gospel, and for growing in the gnosis of that, the almost intimate knowledge of the Son of God. This is the adventure of a lifetime. It doesn't get any better than this. The adventure of the lifetime, we're in it together, we do it together. And the best place to start is together in prayer. So we pray with you, please. Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you for the gifts you have to your children, you have given to your children. Thank you for putting us where you have, in just the perfect place at the perfect time to use the perfect gifts you've given. Holy Spirit, help us to know what those gifts are. Sometimes we struggle with that. Help us to not only know what they are, help us to use them, help us to be bold. Help us to encourage others to build up the body, to grow deeper in our intimate knowledge of you, our triune God. But we can't do it on our own. We will fail. We need your guidance, Holy Spirit. We need your point-blank direction. And so we pray with the ancient church, Bo Ruach Elohim, come, Holy Spirit, make your gifts known. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.